Okay.
All right. Well, I know a lot of you faces.
So you have to introduce yourself. Oh, okay.
All right. And my name is Gilbert Urquizu. I'm with the Fresno County Department of Agriculture. I think I worked with Fresno County about 18 years. I did two stints in fireball. One is an ag specialist. One is a supervisor. I supervised Ridley District, co-supervised Huron District. I was apiary inspector for about 5 years one time. So that's my history with Fresno County. The reason I'm here today, and you guys are my guinea pigs, is I got to start giving this presentation, so you're kind of my first group. What I handed out is the worker protection standards, changes in the California Code of Regulations for pesticides. What happened was the feds are trying to get up to speed with worker protection. They made a lot of changes that forced the state DPR to change a lot of the rules that you guys already enforce. What we're going to go over is our initial interpretation of this. And the comment they gave you, anything that's underlined in here, is a brand new addition to the code. This is actual code that when an inspector shows up that we enforce, this is the code. It's not all of it, just part of it. All the parts that are underlined are brand new and improved. Anything that's kind of got colorized, I'm going to talk about. We'll see how far we get. There's a couple of new things out there in the definitions. Is an application exclusion zone. This is something California had to change because the feds wanted. We'll get to this down the line, but farther in the discussion, basically what it is, when you're applying a pesticide and you've got a rig out there spraying, it varies from 100 feet to 25 feet to no feet that nobody can be inside during the application, which will cause grief for almond guys, orange guys, anybody who uses an air fan or airplane down the way. A new definition is enclosed cab. And I'll talk about that in a bit also. An enclosed cab now is basically your tractor's got the air conditioning and the filtration system works. That's all it does. It doesn't meet the closed system criteria anymore, and it's going to affect the respirator. Back in the day, we'd show up and the guy had a respirator in a plastic bag in the cab. We're like, it's enclosed. We're as inspector happy because we're not checking a nose. We don't like to check anything nose. We don't have to because we got right many nose. And we'd be happy and you guys would be happy. There's a change now. We'll get to that in a little bit down my discussion here. They added something new in this enclosed space, and basically a greenhouse is enclosed space. So we'll pass that one. They gave a new definition of field. Another definition in here is worker housing area. They give a fancy definition, but the problem is they go any place or any land. They got too many anys. So if you see a house, it's worker housing. So, okay, now we're gonna get to the actual code part. Something that's new, it's always been around. If you pay somebody to do your job, an applicator, they have to give you notice they're gonna do it. That hasn't changed. What they added to that is, when you receive your notice, you know, whatever pest control company goes, they have to now tell you the estimated start time and the estimated end time. That's a new little thing. They also need to tell you the application exclusion zone in that notice. So that gets brought in. That's more paperwork on top of the paperwork. Now we'll fast forward to the next code, the completion notice. When they're all done, they actually have to tell you when they started it and when they actually finished the job. Now the tricky part is gonna be, what happens if you got an aerial applicator, he goes out and does one pass, decides it's too windy so he stops, he comes back next week. I don't know how that's gonna be, I'll be honest. That's gonna be interpreted down the line. Somehow they're gonna have to tell you how they started and stopped if they went out two times to do the job. I don't know that part. So I'm just, like I said, I'm the messenger. A lot of this has got to get interpreted in down the future.
Okay, so say you're doing a pesticide use report. Does the guy have to tell you when he started and when he stopped?
No.
That,
we noticed that. It's like, how come you guys and all of us got to look at new stuff, but DPR didn't put that? It's not important at their end? So they didn't change that part. Mm-hmm. We noticed that. And so, And the other part where the applicant start and end is going to come into play for the down here. When you have employees, field workers, or applicators, you have to have all the information for them to come see. That's got to be included at that location, that site. But I'll probably get to that in a bit. Okay, let's see. We'll skip over to something new and approved, 6722, minimum age. Basically 18 years. Can't apply pesticides, mixed load pesticides, if you're under 18 years of age. Or enter a treated field. I have no idea how many people have 17-year-olds out there working, but they put it in writing now. Now, years ago, there was something in the code and it got repealed, because I just reading the book, the code, but they put it back in. That's something new. Now we'll get to the hazard communication. And this is for your handlers. You've got all this information. You have to post it at a central work location, which is the SDS sheets, the recommendations, the materials, the products, all that's still there. What they add to that is, don't ask how they'll enforce it. If you decide you're going to change your doctor, you got to make that change. You have to do that within 24 hours of the change documented. I don't know how we're ever going to know if there was a change. If it was 24 hours or 48 hours, but it's in writing now. The biggest part is, before it was maintained at a central work location. If you have 11 guys or more working at a different location, you have to provide that information at that spot also. And the person I could think of would be, because I spent so much time in Reedley, ground farming, had this huge operation, they had this one building we go to and find everything. Well, they have these shops everywhere, and they'll have an army of guys working. So now they've got to have all this stuff in this shop moved over here where this army's at, or at their fixed decontamination sites. So if you got less than 11 guys, you don't have to worry about it. If you got more than it, and go ahead, Jim.
Do they have to have a specific doctor on that, or they can just have 911 and they're going to be taken to the hospital?
It doesn't have to be a specific doctor. It just has to be a location, a clinic location that they can go to. And it can't be just a 911. It unfortunately has to be...
You can't just put a Madera Community Hospital or Fresno RMC or...
You can put Madera Community Hospital, their address, telephone number, all that's got to be there. It just can't be 911. Because...
That's what they're going to call first anyway, though. 911.
You know what they're going to do? Everyone's gonna grab their cell phone and do it. We all know that. But we have to live with the code. Because if something goes south, we all have, that's what we look at. So I feel your pain. Oh, the only one new thing that's kind of good for you guys, and this is for handler mixer loaders and also for field workers. In the code it says, somebody, let's say you've got an employee that doesn't speak whatever language. He comes to you and he wants to know what pesticides he's been handling. He wants to know all that information. Before it could be, it's got to be in writing now. So it's actually written under, those of you got a handout, go to 6723. Way on the second page at the very end, the person that comes requesting that has to do it in writing, has to say who they are in writing, who they're representing. They have to give the information that they want. But the best part about that is, you're not going to pull it out of your pocket and just hand it to them. They have to give you directions on how it's going to be sent. Is it going to be by mail, email? But you don't just hand it over to them. It'll be like 48 hours you've got to do that. So that, at least it takes a pressure on if someone comes in looking for that information. At least they have to say who they are. Because I know for us, the county, we've had certain anonymous union phone calls that we've actually had to follow up on. Because a call came in and we had to jump all the hoops. And they never said really who they were, but we had to do it. So at least now it's in writing. That's the one thing that's new that's at least benefits you. They got to say who they are. Not that they won't lie, but at least they got to say it. Okay, we'll skip on handler training. Oh, in handler training, so we all have, the handler training is still the same, the 16 points, you check off all the boxes, the heat, the blah, 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 everything, that part's new. is the same. What's new is, I don't know why they added this, but you got your qualified trainer there. I guess they were leaving because now they put it in writing. Whoever your qualified trainer is has to stay there during the entire training. So I guess guys were putting a video in and walking out the door. I mean, I don't know. But they added that part. The other part that's new, when you guys pay somebody for your training, they give you stuff, the training materials back. The source of the training material needs to be listed. It doesn't say where in the code, but you actually have to add the source. So I guess when you're using your, these pesticide flyers, put DPR as a source, if you're using the label, they want that listed now. Before they never said who, they never requested it, but it's got to be there. And also in the training, the person has to be qualified, but somehow we have to document in there the who it was. So I imagine the photocopy of their license would be attached to the training record or the training outline. So those are two new things in regards to pesticide training that's been added. Qualifications, proof of qualifications, and the source of the material for the training. Here we go, Jim. We'll go back to medical care. The new part in the emergency medical care, guy gets sick, whether he's got the flu or whatever, and he does pesticides, he goes to the doctor, you take him to the doctor. That's the big thing. Whenever that ever happens, you do an investigation, don't send him by yourself, because the first question they ask, how did he get there? So make sure you have somebody do it, but they don't do it by themselves. That's a violation. As a side note. But when they go to the doctor, you have to provide the doctor the SDS sheets. That wasn't in the past required. Further down in all the new code, you don't have to have the SDS sheet out in the field, you have to have the label. But if the guy gets sick in the field, you gotta take him to the doctor with the SDS sheets, which used to be the MSDS sheets, the name of the product, and you have to tell the circumstances of the application, the pesticide incident, and a couple other things for common sense, but the newest part is actually taking that sheet. I spoke with DPR on a couple things. You've got all this information you gotta keep. You say it can be electronic, so you could actually take it on an iPhone or something, but I'd recommend if you do any kind of data storage on electronically, there's a couple hazards you gotta worry about. One, the battery goes out. What happens if some inspector or DPR shows up and you have no cell coverage or no data coverage? Those are things you gotta think about. And then when you go to the doctor in this instance, you might want to have a sacrificial iPad or something, because you have to hand it over to the doctor, who knows when you'll get it back. Or the good old-fashioned paper, always works, but it's just, that is coming into play. You can't start using electronic things. Anybody has any questions, just yell at me.
What page do you want?
I'm gonna go to page 12, because this is gonna get us all riled up. Handler decontamination facilities.
Wait here.
Okay. For handlers, when you start the day, listen to the word start, for every handler, and this is not the mixed load guy, but the handler, he's sitting in the tractor driving spray. You start the day with 3 gallons of water with it. Or, so you have to start with 3 gallons of water to start the day. That's the new part. Then you get down to the mixing loading part. Your handler suddenly becomes a mixed loader. You have to have 6 gallons. It doesn't tell you when to start. It doesn't tell you that. For example, if you have 3 guys driving a tractor, we expect you to have the ability to have 9 gallons. Some of it's going to be gone. Their job suddenly, they move over a few feet, start mixing, loading. The same guys, 3 times 6 is 18, but it doesn't say the start of the day. So that means we could randomly show up and there's got to be 18 gallons of water. It's a new dilemma. Then, there's a bunch of ores in here, or you can have the ability to pump out it. 0.4 gallons of water for 15 minutes of water. So if you have a wellhead, it just can't come gushing out. I can tell you right off, we're not going to show up with a bucket and a hose and we're not going to time anything. We have to use common sense. The easiest thing for us to see is something that held sufficient water, the 18 gallons in our example, or if you've got a pump, if you've got a water hose and you can adjust the valve, that'll work. Well, we can't put it in writing, but that'll be common sense, as long as it's not an overhead or so, you know. Those are some of our dilemmas and some of your dilemmas we have to figure out together. But, and the other interesting part is when you get to the field workers, they get to start the game with, just a gallon of water. The problem is, the heat, because I know we had to go through the heat training for us in the county, you have to have more water for the heat requirements than the gallon, so it's a different department, different agency.
Okay, where am I?
Okay, we handled the decontamination, so just play it safe, and for the most part, 6 gallons per person when we show up, and it's all day long until it gets interpreted otherwise. So, and then there's a couple of little caveats in here. Towelettes don't work. You can't use those. Got to be single use like always. And it takes care of that. And we're going to skip all the way to, okay, personal protection. Basically, we'll be on page 15 on the top. And we're going to deal with the enclosed cab, the definition of enclosed cab. So back in the day when they had the definition of enclosed cab, they had some engineering criteria. All we care about was the guy's in the enclosed cab, the windows are closed, the air conditioning works. He's got the respirator sitting in a plastic bag in his vehicle, in his rig. We'd show up. It's an exemption. He doesn't have to be wearing it because he's in an enclosed cab. Going back to the definition of enclosed cab, it's only for dermal protection. And the only respirator, this TC84A, was a simple dust mask respirator with two little rubber bands. That's the only time you can wear it in that enclosed cab. All the other respirators, you've got to be wearing it. And I know that's, because we've actually used to show up to fumigations. And the guys that have their cartridge respirators sitting on the side, but they're in a closed cab. Now they're going to have to wear these things when they're out there working. So that's going to be a headache for all of us. One, all the inspectors have got to learn it, and everybody out in the actual functioning world that's doing the jobs has got to train their employees that the only time you can wear that little dust mist respirator is inside the enclosed cab, and it's got to have, I guess, the air conditioner and the filtration system actually got to be functioning. Just because the door's closed, you don't have no air conditioner. Well, you won't have the windows closed, but
remember, when they're inside the cab, they have to have that little rubber band on when they're driving, even though they're closed cab, the two rubber bands.
If the label says it's TC84, they can actually take it off. It's all the other respirators they have to wear. So the TC84 is exempt. You can take that one off, put it in a bag, and drive around in your rig. It's the other respirators that have to be worn.
If the label requires that.
Yeah. If it requires something other than this, rather greater than this, let's put it that way, those all have to be worn. And we'll skip the equipment maintenance because that's common sense. What else we got? Oh yeah, the for field workers. Okay, this A8 form is for the pesticide mixer loader guys. The A9 is for the field workers. The same criteria for the, if you've got if you start your day at a central location for a field worker, this can just be posted there at your central location. If you have 11 or more out there, you've got to have the A9 posted out there with all the, just filled out the appropriate information. And the basic thing is, if your A9, if the information on the A9 changes, the medical is, then that's, you gotta, by law, you gotta correct it, change it within 24 hours, which is, again, something we're not gonna be able to enforce if we don't know when you do change.
How long is that good for?
Pardon?
That's like 10 for field workers.
It is now, we're getting to that, it's actually for 12 months, and it's gotta be in writing now. So, that's brand new. In the past, it was good for 5 years, and it could have been oral, and I don't know how we were, it was a gray area to enforce it. But now it's all in writing. The feds want it, and the state changed it. So it's one, all your field workers have to be changed. The criteria has not changed, but it's gotta be documented, it's gotta be written. And in that training, they also put in, you've got to prove the trainer's qualified. So either train the trainer certificate, photocopy, stick it on the back, or request it from the other company does it for you. And the source of the training material has to be listed along with the training program, how it was done. So that's added there also.
The PCAs and QALs can still train.
Correct.
PAs are qualified?
Pest control advisors are qualified to train. Yes.
PA.
Pardon?
The PA.
Oh, yes, yes, yes.
That's qualified.
They're qualified to train.
And when you say it's heavy in writing, does that mean you have to hand them a sheet or something?
It's going to be, yes. Just like for the pesticides, and they do the checkoff, I would have it, what are the five? There's the five routes of entry, that just list it all out, have the guy sign it. I'd recommend on the back of the form with all the signatures, have the trainer's document in the back. And that would take care of it. You just do it once a year. In theory, you could actually, if a guy was training with this company, he could take his training record with him and go to another company, but the best thing is just, if you got somebody, just do it fresh every time. Because this way you personally know everything was done correctly. And if you have a field worker, this is going to be repetitive. If they come to you where you keep your application-specific information, just like the pesticide mixer loader handlers, if the representative comes and they want to know what pesticides they were exposed to, what they were working with, where the location is, it's all got to be in writing. It's repetitive. Go to page 17. It basically repeats everything for the mixer loaders. The person requesting has to say who they are, document who they are. The person is... They want it for, it's got to be written down, and the circumstances they believe they were exposed all has to be written on paper. And then you got the 48 hours and the mailing address or email address they got to provide to you. And then the application specific information that they're going to come look for, we're going to go back to the start time and the end time of the jobs that they're at. So they're in a treated field, so 2 weeks ago, somebody went out and put a roundabout there. You bring the information over to your central location, and it says it was, before we looked for the site. Now we actually have to list the crop or the site treated. They've added that part before, we just looked at the site. Yep, site 101 was treated. So you're gonna say 101 and corn. You're gonna have to have the date and the time. You know, start end times of the application there. The SDS sheets there have to be there. That's new, because I guess it used to be MSDS. That's all going to be at that location. In the past, you had it on display for 30 days. So you kept everything up there for 30 days, somebody can come look at it. Now you have to display it for 30 days, but you got to keep that information for 2 years. This can all be done electronically. If you can figure out a way, if it's going to be like in an office like this or a certain location, you can somehow do an electronic version of it. You know, they can go into a computer, an iPad or something. The assumption is you got some kind of directions that they can actually go there. Because access to all that pesticide information is supposed to be unimpeded. So when you're out in the field and they've got the A9, they look at the directions and it says, go to Tom's office, go look to his desk under his clock, he can get there without being stopped by anybody during business hours. And then he can look it up without any assistance. The reality is, we know you guys are going to help, because it's typically a, everybody's on the same page at that point, it's some kind of emergency or something, but if it's another person that's fishing for information, just research, in theory they have to be able to get there and look at it. And that's what we would check if there's a complaint or something. Is everything in place to do that?
Are you referring to the SDS sheet, or the SDS sheet and the application start stop information?
All that.
And who was there and all that?
Okay. Yes, all of it. The whole enchilada. Okay. Yeah, that's the worst part. Okay, now go to page 19, which I don't like. 67, 62, fieldwork during pesticide application.
You wouldn't be able to farm, would you?
Well, I don't know how you guys farm, especially after this one. This is the application exclusion zones. And I was in this training a while back from the feds, and they go, and DPR was actually being trained, they go, so you got this zone that, what happens if the guy's driving, he's spraying Roundup on the road right here, and over here in the exclusion zone, there's another grower, different grower, and there's somebody standing there. Does he have to stop his application? And I like their answer. Goes, oh no, he just has to suspend it until they're gone. That, I mean, suspend, come on.
Suspend.
Yeah. Well, the problem is, go to page 19, we've got an A, a B, and a C. There's a number one. We're going to talk about the area that extends 100 feet horizontally. We're talking all directions in a circle. Aerial or air blast. Then it's got fine mist, blah, blah, blah. What happens? We got guys putting almonds in all over the place. Out on the other side of the valley, we got a bunch of orange. There's houses right up to a lot of these new almonds and a lot of the citrus. You've got an air blast. You basically can't farm for 100 feet. Because how do you know nobody's in that house? Something goes south. Well, how do you... Unless you have a document, we've got a written document. You know, we show up and there's a work order and there's a note from the homeowner, yes, I'm not going to be home today. That would count to me as a document. But without anything like that, you can't do, you have to suspend your application until you know nobody's in there. That's a lot of, it's going to be a lot of headache. Because I'm at the main office. Go ahead.
Where does the house start and stop? Is it the fence? Is it the house? What?
You know what? It's going to be the 100 feet. So if, I'm not talking the fence line because it just says 100 feet. So if, let's say this is your spray rig, whatever, your blast sprayer. Just go out 100 feet. If the property line is here, but nobody's there, well, you know there's no body in that zone. So you can keep on working. The problem is going to be when that house is inside that zone, we can't see into the house to verify nobody's there.
What about a backyard? Now, there's a property line, a backyard, and a house.
Well, see, it's just an exclusion zone. It's not a buffer zone. So that 100 feet can go into somebody else's property. You don't see anybody there. So you can keep right on working. The second somebody opens a sliding glass door or whatever goes out to play some kid, you got to suspend your application. That's going to be our dilemma. And going back to the house, we can't see inside houses. And that's for the airplane, the air blast, and other... I imagine if you're doing the grapes you spray over the top, that's going to probably be 100 feet. The next exclusion zone is 25 feet. So anything that's sprayed 12 inches above the ground has a 25-foot exclusion zone.
What about cars passing by? Because we have a lot of roads around, and they call all the time, oh, you guys spray us. Oh, yeah. Anyway, so it goes down the roads?
Well, your exclusion zone can go into the road.
Cars just suspend their travel.
Yeah, the cars just suspend its travel. So, to do it, in theory, you would actually have to, this is just theory, mind you, you would have to actually just stop, suspend your thing, the car would drive by, then turn it back on again, which is what most guys do with their, if you're doing, you know, you got flaggers out on the road, and they're doing their turns just to watch your traffic, it's just now they put it in writing. So, it'll be a dilemma, because what my fear is going to be once, because this is all public information, Because sitting at the main office, we hear everybody's stuff, concerned citizens, growers, and other environmental people. They're just going to see the buffer zones, and it's going to be a whole bunch of questions. They're not going to sit there. They're going to think it's a buffer zone, not an exclusion zone. So it's going to be a lot of headache in the future for all of us.
When they're talking about sprays, they say pesticides. So if somebody's spraying a fertilizer, it doesn't count.
We don't have any jurisdiction over fertilizer. Mm-hmm. Thank God.
So if somebody's not got sprayed and the guy say, I sprayed you low by urea,
What would happen is they would call us. We would have to call the grower from Pesterim or the arrow, whoever it is, until we found out, oh, it's just urea. Then we're done. Then we have to call the person that complained up and say, you know what? It was a fertilizer application. We don't have any jurisdiction over that. As nice as we can to do, just to be politically correct. But no, we don't do anything with fertilizers. As far as I know, no, I know we don't. So, and they actually have the same criteria. Hopefully nobody's got a greenhouse, because they have the same buffer zone basically for greenhouse. We won't talk about that unless, I don't think anybody has any in here. And this is all pesticides. So if you're out there doing an organic oil that everybody thinks, you know, we still got the exclusion zones for everything.
Hey, do you have to see a person? How about at night? I don't see anybody.
You troublemaker. That's a good question. That means you may actually have to have, it won't be a problem until it's a problem. So that may mean you may have to have somebody out there watching your guys. Just like the aerial guys have spotters. If you use an air blast, you may actually have to have a, because I can actually envision what Tom's talking about. We get a complaint, do an investigation. The commissioner can actually, we've got ranges. They go from $0 to $10,000. A is a big fine, B is an almost one, and C is a paperwork one. But if you had a guy out there just spotting, then you'd be mitigating, and so your fine could be lowered. So you may have to have a person out there to mitigate, to watch. I mean, when you're out there, so something to think about.
Don't spray an avenue.
Don't spray an avenue. Avenues are going to be tough. They already are, but they're just getting tougher. Let's see, what else? Whatever bad news I got for everybody. Well, it's the truth. I mean, it's like, you guys got to enforce it. We've got to learn it, figure out what it says here, and then what actually happens in reality are two different things. And these just came out January 1st of this year. I got an email with some more, so I don't know if they've corrected these or if, I think it's a second batch of new regs that are out in reality.
So these aren't effective yet, Gilbert? These are just
No, these are effective. If it's got, unfortunately, if it's got a black line on it, it's law as of January 1st of this year. So, oh, and we've got to the, we already covered this part, the training. It's got to be a right field worker training. It's got to be, right, go back, right. You go, am I going backwards? No, I'm going backwards. So I think. Oh, yeah. Let's go to page 22.
Yeah.
Field worker decontamination.
I'm okay. Just a second. Let me get outside. Uh-huh. Yeah. So,
they've got all kinds of criteria here. Where you go to, basically, we're in little A, number one. So, where it talks about 1 gallon of water. Or employee, then it goes, or three for people engaged in early activity entry. But that's the start of the day because it's got start. Nope, that one doesn't have it. I've been just staring at this too long. But the basic new part to the field worker is they put in writing the water must be certain temperature, they don't quite describe. It's basically, they don't want anything that's going to cause damage. Then it repeats about the towelettes.
Sir.
Oops. And I think I'm pretty much gonna be there. There's a couple more pages. Oh, last but not least, field posting is brand new.
On the west side.
Page 26.
I did only.
They've added. You're applying a pesticide. It's got an REI of greater than 48 hours. You must post it.
Fine.
So that's brand new and improved. Something that's semi-new. What's basically, I'm going to tell you, this is my interpretation of what's happening in the future. We've got the brand new regs that if you got an REI greater than 40 hours, you got to post it just like any other pest, just like you had a some kind of a, you know, the skull, the crossbones, the date, the time, all that's got to be there. What's new, going back to 618 notification, it's been around a few years, but we haven't really enforced it, but it's coming up. Let's say the middle of the night, you decide, you've got a field right here, and then you've got a field right here. Middle of the night, you decide, I better go out and put roundabout here. You've got people over here. These people need to know prior to you even starting this job. Because I actually had this happen. I had to do a huge investigation over something over this. It was like a $5,000 fine. The company was awesome. They knew where every person was every second of the day. They had people come out to check on these people. They had it all. But what happened was they were doing a job here. They didn't finish it. These guys all show up to pick peaches or whatever over here. These people didn't know this was happening. They got a violation notice because they weren't notified. The only way they could have prevented the violation notice would have been if they'd have posted their sign saying being treated by pesticides. The product only had a 12-hour REI. It was you know, benign fungicide type of thing. But the technicality was they didn't know about it. So the way to prevent that was if they'd have posted it, these guys showed up, then they're notified. And that's been existing for a few years now. It's just that the only time it comes up is when somebody gets dinged for it. Yeah, we had the one I did a couple years ago, it was like $400 or $500, but there was 40 some people, so it was like a $5,000 fine. Nobody got sick. It's a third party called up. This is where that 48 hours is representing. Some third party called up to complain that people were in a dangerous situation. We had to go out and do our investigation. And that was the casualty of the whole investigation.
How many notices on any given field do you have to have?
You have to have, it's going to depend on your label. Because some labels say posting and oral. So in that case, it would be a double notification. If there's no posting requirement, but it's got the, you know, the greater than, that sign itself is a notification. And my gut tells me is anytime somebody shows up, because we actually got, well, actually I'll say them ground down the way down to Kerman. Every time they go out and do anything, they put their little skull and crossbones keep out on everything they do, whatever it is. Now, because you go drive down the field and they just got the little signs up, they do the job, then they're done. They yank them and they go, just so that they're covered.
But you have to have it on like every half mile, like you're doing.
It would be the quarter. It's
like you're doing a half mile on each side.
For regular posting is at the corners and every 600 feet, and points of access. But if you had a chain link fence or a ditch that you couldn't cross, that's not a point of access. So I would just say corners, points of access, especially if it's not required by the label. If it's just you want to cover your butt and put a sign out. So in a nutshell, the biggest things to worry about are going to be the posting of the 48 hours, the application exclusion zones, the decontamination of water requirements, the enclosed cab. So the enclosed cab thing is, if you're using the simple respirator, the dust mask thing, they could take it off, stick it in a bag if they're in a closed cab. All of the respirators they gotta wear, regardless. Those are the most important things I could think of to remember. And any other questions, just prove, you can look through this thing. I got some cards up here. You can give me a call. We can come to the office. We can talk about them. But I'll admit, it's overwhelming for me. And I know for everybody else, too. It's got to be, just watching today, you got 1,000 things you got to keep track of. So
this is
anyway.
This is for the whole state of California.
The entire state of California. And I'm speaking for Fresno County, so I don't know how other counties will interpret the exact same literature. But I do know I was talking to the deputy down at Kings, and we're going, the 100-foot part and the house, we're all on the same page with that. And I imagine Madera County, because Bill, the guy who should have been here, he got a job and works for Madera County, because he used to work for us for like 17 years, so he'll probably be on the same page. So, that's all I got. Any kind of questions or anything? I'm here.